Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is TWiT. Bandwidth for Triangulation is brought to you by CacheFly at CacheFly.com. This is Triangulation, episode 182, recorded November 23rd, 2014, for airing December 29th, 2014. Ian Urbina and the Secret Life of Passwords. Triangulation is brought to you by Personal Capital. With Personal Capital, you'll have many more happy holidays as you grow and protect your wealth with this award-winning financial app. Best of all, it's free. To sign up, go to personalcapital.com/triangulation. Welcome to Triangulation. Leo Laporte here. Triangulation is the show where we get a chance to talk to some of the most interesting, smartest, most provocative people on the internet. And today we're going to do something a little bit different. First of all, we're recording this on a Sunday. The same Sunday, November 23rd, that an article came out in the New York Times Magazine on the secret life of passwords. It's actually one of those great New York Times multimedia pieces with a lot of video and illustrations. The author of the article is an investigative reporter in Washington, D.C. for the New York Times, Ian Urbina. He joins us now from his home in D.C. Ian, thanks for joining us.
Well, thanks for having me.
Tell me how you got the idea for the secret life of passwords.
I got it because in talking with friends, I found that often discussion of passwords would veer towards the negative and the sort of ranting, and I would partake like everyone else.
Everybody hates them.
Yeah, there's a lot to hate about them. But at the same time, I always harbored this certain fascination with the other sort of the subspecies of passwords that seem to exist, at least in my repertoire, which were those that had other emotions associated with them, you know, fond memories or kind of inside jokes with myself or, you know, kind of nostalgia to, you know, things that, you know, the girl that broke my heart in college or a lyric from a song. And I thought that that subspecies never got discussed, and so I started asking people whether they too had any passwords that were like that, and virtually everyone I talked to seemed to have such passwords.
It's the bane of my existence. Our job to tell people how to keep their stuff secure. Our job is to say, and I do it all the time, oh no, you know, for passwords, A, you should have a unique password for every single password. It should never duplicate. B, that password is best when it's a completely random and lengthy string of upper and lowercase letters, numbers, and punctuation marks. And, of course, completely unmemorable, which is why we always tell people to use a password manager. However, I don't do that.
Right.
And a lot of people don't do that. I've gotten better at it, and certainly the most secure passwords, my bank password, my Amazon password, the stuff where people could really rip me off, I do that. But for the New York Times, for example, my login there, it's not going to be a password that I can't remember. It's going to be something that I can type easily on a smartphone. And I think a lot of people, well, we all know people use birth dates, anniversaries, kids' names, dogs' names. But what surprised me about your article is that these passwords often are much more emotionally laden than just a birth date or an anniversary.
Yeah, I mean, like you say, these are the anti-password passwords, right? So they're the ones that, like you mentioned, you know, they're not disposable. People carry them with them, you know, through life, which is a bad idea from a security perspective. They're not a meaningless string of characters. They are associated with something related to your life, and a good hacker could probably figure it out often. They're not meaningless. You know, they're quite the opposite. And when you start talking with people about them, they're things like their name of their dog or their wife's anniversary. Just as frequently I found there's an even richer backstory to them. And I think that's for obvious reasons. They're chosen because they're easier to remember because they're emotionally burnt into your brain. But I think I started theorizing that, there's another reason that people have these, and I think it's sort of it's an irrational sentimentality that is common to people, and I just think humans generally like crave order and meaning, and so they try to put it wherever it's lacking, and so they incline towards using things that have significance. So I felt like there was something deeper going on motivating people to do this.
Sometimes people use them as an affirmation because it's something you may type every day, maybe several times a day. You talk about the prison inmate who used his inmate identification number as his password. He said, as a reminder not to go back.
Yeah, I mean, people use them as affirmations, sort of emotional markers, and sometimes they're nebulous, you know, like the example you cite. Other times they're very concrete, motivational totems, you know, so quit smoking now, you know, call mom, you know, save on calories, you know, you know,
quit smoking. Every time they log on, quit smoking. Does it work?
The one guy who told me that, Maurizio Estrella, said it did work for him.
Wow.
You know, just because it was a constant reminder.
Yeah.
And some people also use, a lot of athletes I found used, you know, the time that they wanted to run in the marathon next year.
Or,
and it was just sort of a constant mental exercise to refresh that value.
I use a password. I was talking about this on the air, so I guess I could tell you now. I use a variation of the above, so when I read this article, I went, oh, I do that. Now, right, I'm supposed to use random long strings, and I do that for the most important stuff. But for a long time, even my PGP password was based on an experience I had 20 years ago. In the mid-90s, I was on a TV show called The Site on MSNBC, and it was a really horrible experience for me. I had created the show, was promised a role in it, but when it came time to do it, the NBC executives said they didn't want me on camera because they hated how I looked. But they said, don't worry, we got a job for you. You're going to be a virtual character. And Soledad O'Brien, who was the anchor of the show, was sitting at a coffee bar. She was looking at a dot because I was not visible to her, so she had to just kind of read her lines to a dot. I was way in the back. Karsten knows this because he was my puppeteer. I've told this story before. I was way in the back wearing a funny suit with dots on it and attached to a large computer. Karsten was spinning my hair, and another puppeteer, Christina, was making my eyebrows jump. And I was talking, and then Soledad would pretend to talk to me. It was a horrible experience. But Soledad, at one point during this, and maybe it was on the air, maybe not, said, you know, my mother hates you. And I said, what? She says she calls you the vile little puppet man. She says every day, she says, do you have to be with that vile little puppet man again? So Dad said, yeah, Mom. And this was the job was horrible. I hated what I was doing. And that was just the icing on the cake. And Soledad's mom hated me and called me a vile little puppet man. And for even to this day, my kind of generic password is a play on Vile Little Puppet Man. I once wondered why I keep... this is a painful memory.
But it's humorous. I mean, what I found is that just like that story, it's so intimate and it's so specific and it's so unique that no one else could have it, right? It's a 20-variable equation as an anecdote.
It is unique. I don't think any hacker could find out. Of course, I've just mentioned it on the air. But.
And so that's why that was the marvel of the reporting experience. You rarely, if you approach someone that you don't know, or even people you do know, and you try to get that far in, you know, tell me an obscure random anecdote that was both humorous and painful from long ago. You won't get there most likely.
Right.
Without alcohol being involved, you know. And so what was strange about this topic was it was almost like a portal that once it clicked for people, if you got lucky, you suddenly were there in that space with them, and they were telling you this story from when they were 8 or when they were 28, but it was the type of thing that you wouldn't have gotten from them any other way. They're also very, just like yours, usually a mix of things, partially funny, partially tragic, partially bizarre. And that mix is partially what made them so memorable to the person. So it was a really fun reporting experience, I got to say.
How long have you been collecting these?
I've been collecting them for about 4 years.
Wow.
And very, not in any, only the last year has been a very decided fashion. It was sort of just a hobby before that. I felt like there was something, there was a real vein there. And so over Thanksgiving and holidays and on a plane, when I was looking for something to discuss, I would bring it up with people. And I had a little notebook where I would keep it all. And then about 6 months ago, I mentioned it to an editor. And usually when I described it to people, even up to the very end, and I hadn't shown any text to anyone, there was this awkward, interesting thought, you know, and then they would sort of edge away. it didn't register. But then when I wrote it and showed it to a couple editors, they said, oh, now I get it. Now I get it.
Yeah. We're talking to Ian Urbina. He's the author of a story in the Sunday New York Times for November 23rd called The Secret Life of Passwords. It's also online. And if you can, read it online because it's one of those great multimedia pieces the New York Times does so well online with videos and audio and so forth talking about it. We're going to take a break. We'll come back with more on The Secret Life of Passwords right after this. So our show today and actually all year long, and it's kind of nice, has been brought to you by the great folks at Personal Capital. A product that started on Triangulation, I'm happy to say. Bill Harris, its founder, was on the show a couple of years ago talking about it. I signed up then, and I've been very happily using it. In fact, I noted that it's on iTunes this week. You know, they have that thing for people who got a new iPad or a new iPhone, apps you should have, and it's one of them in the finance section. And I agree. As you make resolutions for this new year, mine include eat healthier, work out more, invest smarter. That's one we can all get behind. I want to tell you about something you can do that's free, secure, easy, and I love it. It's an online app, Personal Capital. As I said, iPhone, iPad, also Android, even Android Wear, which is really cool. You add it to your to-do list for 2015. It's already helping more than 700,000 investors just like you and me manage and grow our wealth. It's a complete financial dashboard. You get all your accounts in one place. That helps you make smarter financial decisions. Not budgeting, of course, not just what your net worth is, but also manage your portfolio, your investments. And, you know, if we don't plan for the future, that's not good. I'll tell you, as somebody who is approaching retirement in the next 10 years, I'm kind of glad that I've been paying attention. And I wish I'd paid a little closer attention when I was a younger fella. Use Personal Capital's technology to grow your wealth. Find and eliminate high mutual fund and 401k fees, other hidden brokerage fees. You also get tailored advice on optimizing your investment. Things like rebalancing your portfolio, which is something I knew nothing about until I started using Personal Capital. And now I'm like a zealot. Why wait? Taking control of your financial future is one of the most important things you can do for 2015. Personal Capital. It's free. It's easy. It's secure and safe. And if you go to personalcapital.com/triangulation, you can try it right now. No cost, no obligation. It's very, very nice. personalcapital.com/triangulation. And we thank them so much for their support all year long and going into 2015 of Triangulation. We're talking The Secret Life of Passwords with Ian Urbina. He is a reporter for the New York Times. You're an investigative reporter.
Yeah, so what that means is I just work on longer digs, you know.
Nice. You get more time.
I do. It's a luxury, I got to say.
Slow journalism, Stephen Levy calls it.
That's exactly right.
Like slow cooking. How fun. And since you're in D.C., I guess you do a lot of politics.
Actually, I don't. I just happen to be in D.C. I don't do any politics. I do... long series. And so I did a long series on oil and gas industry. And then after that, I did a series on worker safety. And now I'm working on a series about the high seas and the maritime world.
Oh, neat. So this was kind of a hobby, a little something you kept in back pocket.
Very much so. Yeah. It was something that, you know, felt more essay than journalism, and I've never written anything in the first person. So, and it was not news. It was it was truly a duck-billed platypus. And again, I was really lucky that they saw any value in it and let me run with it.
It's funny because I've been talking about and thinking about and working with people and their passwords for 20 years. And I guess I never really realized the richness of the stories behind people's passwords, mostly because people don't just volunteer their passwords.
Yeah. I mean, that was, I mentioned in the story that, there's something inherently destructive about, we as reporters invade the things we study, and we just by engaging with them and writing on them, we alter them. And that's true for any subject you handle. You enter the story invariably. Right. In this case, it was even more destructive because in the very act of people telling me their password, they had to give them up. You know, and these were often very intimate things that they'd carried for two decades, sometimes, you know, since college. And now they told it, and I planned on using it, and I would always ask permission and lean on them a little bit. But, and, you know, that meant that they had to no longer use them. But again, so why were people willing to do it? Why were they willing to tell me and let me use them? I got the sense that the best answer I could come up with was that there is a general frustration and exhaustion and tension that is created by the overload of information and the fears of security that are sort of inherent to all of our lives and our relationship with technology. And my impression was that this was a rare, cathartic, irrational release that people could have, where they just sort of found something pretty in all that tension, and also found something where they could almost thumb their nose at all that pressure. And so they just offered up their story. That was my best guess at why people kept doing it, but they kept doing it.
I think there's something about these times. Maybe people have always been this way. There's this kind of urge to confess, this confessional aspect to it too. Like, I just got to tell somebody. It felt good to tell you my story. Maybe it's you.
Right. We've all become, you know, armchair psychiatrists. Yeah.
I think you did in your research, talk to psychiatrists and sociologists about these passwords and what they might mean?
I did. Yeah. Less psychiatrists, more kind of academics who study, just smart people in general, but academics who specialize on the relationship between technology and society and such. There was one term from a guy named Paul Sappho out at Stanford, a crypto haiku. We had this conversation.
I love that.
Yeah, and it was just the perfect, you know. He and I fixated on the concision of it all, in a 6 or 10 or 12 character code that you could pack so much information in there is really, it's like a clown car. You open the door and an impossible amount spills out. And so, you know, he and I were riffing on that whole marvel of it. And he said, yeah, it's kind of like crypto haiku. And I just paused and thought, I'm stealing that.
I love Paul Sappho. That's hysterical. You say, you talk about some people who said they used incorrect as their password, so that when they forget it, the software will say, your password is incorrect. And they'll go, oh, yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
But you also talk about Nicole Perlroth, who is the New York Times cybersecurity reporter, who has uses a password. Why don't you tell the story?
Yeah. So I think I can say it now because Nicole.
I'm sure she's changed it.
Yeah. Oh, well, I know she changed it. But the gray lady, the copy editors at the New York Times refused to let me actually put the word bitch in the paper, even though it was Nicole's password. And
her password was bitch.
Well, so the story is this. Her password was hush bitch.
Ah, and that's great.
The story behind it was, and I hope I do it justice because I don't want to mess it up, but she was in a store in San Francisco and there was an exchange across the counter between two sketchy guys and the store owner. One of the store attendants said, I think these guys may have just taken something. And the store owner said, no, certainly not. They're fine. The guys left and the store owner's cell phone was gone. And the store owner felt really chagrined that she had called it wrong. And so she sent a text to her own cell phone saying, hey, I think you may have mistakenly taken my cell phone. And, you know, if you did, could you just leave it, you know, at the cafe up on the corner, and you know, no charges will, you know, will be pursued, etc. And the response that she got was hush bitch. And Nicole just thought that was so hilarious that she adopted it as her password. And it just struck me as yet again, like, there's a great little vignette
in two words,
right?
Amazing. What are some of the other passwords you dug up?
Let's go to the dark. You know, there was one lady I talked with early on. I was at the park with my kid. I have an 11-year-old son. He was on the jungle gym, and I was standing next to this woman, and she proceeded to tell me. I told her about stories I work on, and this was one of them I mentioned. And she said, oh, yeah, that's funny. I have a password story. And she said, my son committed suicide a couple years ago, 2 years ago. And, she was in his room, I think, sort of just remembering him. And she came across a piece of paper with what looked like his password written on it. And the password was Lambda 69. And this lady didn't have any idea what that might mean. So she got on the internet and started poking around, just trying to figure out why would it be Lambda 69? And she saw that Lambda is often a common symbol in gay history and gay culture. There are different interpretations as to what it means, but one common one is that it sort of stands for liberation. And 69 is lots of things. It's a number, but it's also a date, 1969, of the Stonewall riots, which is a, you know, big moment in gay history. And this lady started thinking, wait a minute, and she started piecing some things together, and before long she realized that her son had been gay.
Wow.
And she hadn't known that. So here again, sort of tucked in a password inadvertently discovered was a lot of poignancy.
No kidding. Yeah. People are in the chat room are being made very uncomfortable by this whole subject because they say people are telling their passwords. They're revealing, but I think that's nobody's doing it unwillingly. And I think there is something, it's cathartic to say. It felt great to tell you my story. And I'm sure that this woman, now she may not be using Lambda 69, or she wasn't, he was, but I think that was an amazing revelation about her son, that, and he had encapsulated that very personal identity into that password, that short password.
Yeah, it's, I mean, before we move the story, we looped back for the third time and checked with everyone. And
oh, you
said,
did?
You know, my father was in the story, my son was in the story, my wife was in the story, and, you know, and then lots of strangers, and we went back to every single one, you know, and said, we just want to make
sure.
Yeah. Even old accounts that you've forgotten. And So
you know that these are all safe to reveal. You don't reveal all of them. You talk around some of them.
I don't know. Maybe this is where I will make people even more frustrated, but I kind of feel that if hackers want to get at you, they're going to get at you. And I'm not sure that these little anecdotes are going to equip them any more than they already are equipped.
I think you talk about this. There are people who kind of intentionally publish their passwords. They tell people their passwords with that very philosophy in mind that, you know, they're going to get you anyway. So why hide it?
Yeah. So I refer to those folks as digital nudists, because in a funny way, they're kind of like walking around the beach with no clothes on.
Woo!
And they're just sort of like, look, if you're not comfortable with it, then go someplace else. And these weren't necessarily folks that tell everyone their passwords, but rather they're folks that intentionally chose you know, the dumb passwords that you're told not to choose. And their logic was, first of all, there's this sense of futility that so many people feel, you know, you read a that you can't really protect yourself anyway, and maybe that's ill-advised, but people feel it. But secondly, their thought was strength in numbers. You know, we're just going to get lost, hopefully, in the crowd, and I don't have that much that they want to, you know, I won't be targeted in particular. I'm not, you know, a high-profile figure, and so I'm just going to choose password as my password,
right.
And hope for the best.
You refer to, apparently this has been a problem for some time because the Seinfeld sitcom talked about passwords at least a couple of times.
Yeah, there's
George Costanza's wouldn't reveal his ATM password.
Yeah, so there's this famous funny episode where George Costanza is being George Costanza, which is neurotic and uptight.
Chatroom knows the answer already. They're already saying it.
Bosco.
Yeah.
That's right. So, so
he was embarrassed by it.
He was embarrassed, but it also gets to the point that, you know, he loves his sort of hidden love for that chocolate sauce is why he chose it.
Jerry Seinfeld's was Jor-El.
Yeah, so I got riveted, and this is when, you know, wife and friends said, you might be going down the rabbit hole here. Maybe we need to stage an intervention. You're getting too obsessed, you know. But I thought the Jerry Seinfeld one was utterly riveting because, so his ATM code on the show was Jor-El, and Jor-El is Superman's father, and there ends the story. Mm-hmm. But when you dig a little bit more, you find out that Jerry Seinfeld, the person, his father's name is Kalman, and he goes by Cal, and Cal-El was Superman, and I'm forgetting the planet that they're from.
Krypton,
Krypton, right? His Kryptonian name, and Jerry Seinfeld, the person, named one of his sons. His son's middle name is Cal, after Jerry Seinfeld's father, and so what riveted me about all this was that, as you look into these little codes, you start seeing an interesting circularity from comic books to real life, from past to future, from, you know, this person's actual life to his on-screen life. And there was just this amazing intertwined element that I thought was riveting, and it was around the same time that I was pondering that tangled knot that I was also thinking and talking with the author of this famous book, Godel Escher Bach, which is a book a lot about. It's a musing on some of the loops that you find in art and music and science. So I just thought, oh wow, these things all seem to echo, at least in my head.
You talked to Doug Hofstetter about it, the author of Godel Escher Bach.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah. And he's a really smart guy.
Was he impressed? Or?
I don't know. I mean, if I was really honest, I think he was.
Oh, is this guy?
I would say no. Yeah, I think exactly. I got that, you know, kind of like a quizzical. Yeah. He was perfectly kind, but there was a sort of quizzical element to his. But on the other hand, once we warmed up a little bit and I told him, he got the idea, he definitely embraced the notion of the keepsake password and in fact told me his. So he could relate to that, but and I think he definitely agreed and said that there is a fundamental desire to find meaning and to find, and keepsake passwords is likely a part of that. But whether the loops that he talked about in Godel Escher Bach are the exact same loops that I was finding in some of these passwords, that I don't know.
You say he's used the same password since his Stanford days at 1975. And it was, of course, it's fitting. It was a word problem combined with a sentimental date from his past. A word problem. Eh, perfect. Right. See, are some people have really kind of complicated, bizarro passwords? I mean, a word problem, really?
Yeah.
Why not your dog's name, really? Come on, let's make it simple. Yeah.
And what was funny about that, too, is, you know, you start seeing what people value. So with him, it wasn't just a word problem. It was one of the hardest word problems that he had ever encountered. And my interpretation, he didn't say this, is that this is a super smart guy who loved word problems all his life, and he was not accustomed to being stumped, at least temporarily. And here was one that had stumped him, and that almost, you know, that stimulated him. And that's why it was one of his favorites. Well, that tells you something about the guy. And there it is in his password.
Were there any that really surprised you?
The Lutnick story, you know, there was this story, this anecdote at the beginning of the piece about...
This is powerful, yeah, yeah.
And you can tell it or I can tell it. It takes a little telling.
Well, I don't think if you mentioned the firm Cantor Fitzgerald, there are not many people who won't go, oh, because, of course, that was a financial services firm that was nearly wiped out in 9/11. 658 Cantor Fitzgerald employees died when one of the planes hit the tower. Howard Lutnick, the CEO, survived and had the not very enviable task of, as you might imagine, reconstructing the passwords of many of these employees to accounts that they needed access to if the firm were to continue on. So he had to actually call, and this is, God, it must have been horrible, family members. Now, Microsoft, understanding the problem, sent a team in to brute force as many of these passwords as they could. But it turned out they didn't need to brute force a lot of them because, as you've been saying, many of these passwords weren't particularly secure. They were related to memories from people's lives. And so I guess he was calling the families of people who were killed in 9/11 saying, well, I'm so sorry about your loss. Can you tell me a little bit about him and what's the name of your family dog? What was your anniversary date? That must have been a very difficult thing to do.
Yeah, when I called him, you summarized it perfectly. And when I called him, I had heard this anecdote from a source who was among the Microsoft team that was sent in, but I wasn't allowed to use it. So I had to go to Cantor Fitzgerald directly. And I finally got to the CEO, and we were on the phone, and he recounted this experience. And wow. Don't forget, you know, among those who were killed was Howard Lutnick, the CEO's brother.
Wow.
And so this was a extremely difficult time. And yet here he was, like you say, making these calls. And in the middle of the call, Mr. Lutnick began to cry. And I remember just being struck by everything about the topic. A, its poignancy. B, its surprising pathos and... just sort of, it felt like virgin snow. It was this place that, you know, you were wandering through the woods and suddenly you came across a meadow where no one had walked on that before. And topically, that's what this felt like. Here again was yet another case where in this almost irrational, illogical way, the very thing that that allowed for the survival of this firm was the very thing that made their passwords human and weak. It's this personal stuff that people use to make them. And that's what allowed them to be hacked in the time frame they needed them to be hacked in, which was, you know, the firm was back up online and in the bond market within 48 hours. They had a team of 30 Microsoft folks, and they had lots of other folks calling family members as well, going through this. They actually had a checklist, a list of questions that they were supposed to ever so gently ask the loved ones. Mm. But anyway, that was one of the more amazing interactions of the story.
We're talking with Ian Urbina. He's the author of a book. It should be a book. Maybe it will be a book. You get and I know you're continuing to collect passwords. An article in the Sunday Times for November 23rd, The Secret Life of Passwords. You should look at it online if you can, because it's got a ton of multimedia content videos talking about the various passwords. It's nicely done. As is often the case, the Times has really found a new way of telling these stories online that it's just exceptional. You mentioned you have an 11-year-old son. You talk about his password. Yeah, I'm sure he's changed it by now, but his password in the article.
Yeah. So, you know, the night before the story went live, I had a reckoning with him, and he was really annoyed with me that I had to force him to go into his account and change his password. He didn't want to, and he felt really put out by it. His password was philosophy, and he had told me he chose it because a couple years before, he had never heard of the word philosophy and certainly didn't know the definition. And when he learned it, he was sort of proud of himself for knowing such a big concept. And so he embraced it, used it as a password. And again, maybe pushing the point too far, what struck me as especially riveting about that was when I was in high school and in college, I had a password which was based on a concept I'd heard in high school biology class or studied called, the term is ontology recapitulates phylogeny. And it basically means in the biological development of an individual animal, you can see the stages of evolution of that species. And I thought that was fascinating, almost like fractal, you know, fractals meets biology. I was blown away by it. And so I started using a version of that as my password. So here was my son using a philosophically riveting concept as his password. And it made me think of my having done very much the same thing when I was younger. And all that, to me, felt, worth noting, at least.
You know what I find interesting to think about? You know, we're not really digital natives. We didn't have to have passwords when we were your son's age. But kids growing up, you know, now, my kids and your kids, they will have had passwords their whole life. And I wonder if what you'll notice 20 years from now is most of these passwords are, you know, like SpongeBob, our kid-focused memories, because that's when they had to come up with their first passwords.
That's a good point. Yeah, I do wonder whether your and my great-grandkids will have passwords, right?
I hope they don't. I hope they don't.
I would be surprised if they did.
Yeah, I would too.
But I certainly know that our great-grandparents didn't have passwords, and in all likelihood, our great-grandchildren won't either. So if you think about this in a historical sense, this is only a blink of an eye in history when passwords are this huge, almost universal reality, even a shackle that most of the world has to deal with. Rich, poor, young, old, first world, third world, everyone has to deal with technology. And so, but there's only probably a 50, 60-year window in history when that will be the case. And so a side of me felt like someone needs to do, like Hawking's did, you know, a brief history of passwords, you know, that looks at the rise and fall of this strange cultural institution.
This brief moment in time. Right. So you're still collecting passwords.
Yeah, so the hope here is to roll out smaller but subsequent stories from people's keepsake passwords, which is this subspecies that we reported on. So we're really eagerly looking for people to email me with their own keepsake stories.
Urbina, U-R-B-I-N-A @nytimes.com if you'd like to share your story. And Soledad, if you're watching, it's because of you that I have this horrible password. The other day I was typing it thinking, why am I, this is like the reverse affirmation. Like I'm saying how vile I am every time I type my password. I'm going to change it to something positive.
But it's a reckoning, and it's also, it's proof that you have a sense of humor about yourself. So in some ways, I think
good. Ian, I noticed in this whole thing, you haven't shared any of your current passwords.
My current ones, yeah. Well, I'm not a digital nudist. I'm fully clear.
Really worth reading, The Secret Life of Passwords. It is both funny and moving and just fascinating. And it does get you thinking about your own password choices. It's in the Sunday Times for November 23rd. But you can also find it online if you search for New York Times and The Secret Life of Passwords. You'll find it quite quickly. It's author, our guest, Ian Urbina. Ian, thanks for joining us today.
Leo, thank you very much.
Great to talk to you.
Likewise.
We do triangulation. Normally, this is a special Sunday edition, but normally we do triangulation on Mondays, 11 a.m. Pacific, 2 p.m. Eastern Time, 1900 UTC, and you can watch live. And I love it if you do, because I get a lot of mileage out of the chat room questions, so please do. If you can't, though, on-demand audio and video are always available after the fact. twit.tv/TRI or on our YouTube channel, youtube.com/triangulation. And if you want every episode, just subscribe in your favorite podcast client or get one of those great Twit apps. There's a lot of them for every platform, thanks to our independent developers who are working very hard to make it possible for you to watch Twit on your mobile device. Thanks for joining us, and we'll see you next time on Triangulation.